We have with us right now from the OCTA Research Group, Father Nicanor Austriaco. Father Nick, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen, and good morning to you, our viewers.
All right, let's start with the Department of Health describing the Philippines already as a low risk. The WHO yesterday cautioned the DOH, but in terms of the metrics, the barometer for this, the indicators, are we not low risk as of yet?
So risk is determined by numbers. And the numbers here, based upon the metrics established by the DOH, suggest that the risk to the health infrastructure of the country is low. So it's not necessarily a risk to the individual Filipino, even though that risk in certain places in the Philippines is at a low point now as compared to the last 6 months, particularly in the NCR. But for the most part, I think what the DOH is saying is that if you look at the numbers, the risk of a devastating surge to our healthcare infrastructure is quite low.
Okay, so but would it be a messaging problem to say low risk? The Philippines is low risk.
Well, see, one of the challenges is that I've had individual citizens text me and talk to me, and they're asking, is it low risk for them? And does that mean they can remove their face mask because the risk is low? And in that particular, in that case, I would say no. In fact, our risk for individual infection is not low enough that you can remove your face mask.
Mm-mm-mm. When would it be low enough or appropriate holistically to say a country is low risk? And do you label yourself as low risk, frankly, or should the World Health Organization or an outside body say this country is low risk?
Well, I think that's a matter of policy, and different countries throughout the world have adopted different policies and different metrics. But the experience of Israel after the very successful vaccination campaign is that the risks will drop significantly once the average daily attack rate, the ADAR, falls below one. Okay. And that would be about less than 100 cases in the NCR per day.
Okay. The WHO yesterday advised against using the words herd immunity because Dr. Rabi said that with the new variants, you'd have to vaccinate 85% of a population to achieve herd immunity, unlike before it was 70%. So he uses population protection himself, and he says the targets are 10% of the population by September, 40% of the population by end of the year, 70% by July next year. So he says the Philippines is actually on target. Would you agree? He even said we're doing a good job.
Well, I mean, my particular focus, given the attack strategy of the virus, has always been to emphasize the vaccination of the NCR plus and now the NCR plus 8. And as of yesterday, the NCR has received 29% of single doses, and each LGU has vaccinated between 20% to 70% of their population one dose, which suggests that a month from now, or a month and a half from now, that will be fully vaccinated people. And so, yes, the data suggests that in a few months, the NCR particularly may be Delta resilient. And if this is the case, this is good news for the country.
Okay. So far, we are seeing a change in quarantine protocols for fully vaccinated people. Do you agree with these new protocols?
Well, I mean, one of the big question marks with quarantines is that different vaccines may have different transmissibilities. So the data we have now suggests that Pfizer and Moderna and AstraZeneca individuals who've been vaccinated with these vaccines are not highly transmissible. We're not sure about Sinovac and some of the other vaccines, which is why there's this deep uncertainty about what do we do with individuals who are doubly vaccinated with different vaccines?
But what about the Turkey studies in real life, wherein Sinovac showed efficacy of something like more than 80 plus percent after the second vaccine? Did you read that?
Yes, one of the things we have to distinguish here is between what is called effective immunity, where I do not get sick,
okay,
versus sterilizing immunity, which means I don't get sick and I cannot give it to you.
I see.
So the efficacies that you are quoting tell me that I cannot get sick.
Yeah.
There's still a possibility that I can carry the virus and give it to you.
Okay.
So that's what we're waiting for Sinovac and some of the other vaccines. We have that data now for Pfizer and Moderna, especially from the Israeli experience and the UK experience with AstraZeneca. So those countries suggest that those vaccines prevent transmission as well, which is why they're able to remove masks. So in the United States, we remove masks now, even though only 45% or so have been fully vaccinated, because the idea is that at that number, the transmission is substantially lower. We are hoping for something like that by Christmas, at least in the NCR plus 8. But we have to wait until we get more data from particularly Sinovac to really see what transmissibility is all about.
Okay, the quarantine protocols, for example, we've seen that special session in Cebu where Governor Gwen Garcia, although they are following IATF protocols now, but you do have many people already complaining that it's so expensive to be staying in a hotel for 14 days, people spending 100,000, 200,000, some hotels taking advantage, even asking that family members split up hotel rooms instead of, let's say, they live in one home, so they could stay in one room, but it's not that way. What Cebu was doing was swab upon arrival. If tested negative, just quarantine 3 days and then go to your home, and then swab on the sixth or seventh day again, but still stay at home. So it's less cost. And even for mental health, you know, it's safer for many, and emotionally, it's just healthier emotionally than to be staying in a hotel room for 14 days. What do you make of these innovative protocols that Cebu was doing?
So Karen, let me begin. You know, I spent 10 days in a hotel in Manila when I returned here in May.
Yeah.
So I appreciate the isolation. I appreciate the cost. The challenge is that, especially with the Delta threat, so the threat of the Delta variant is such that if one person was carrying the Delta variant and returned home, it is absolutely certain that that person will infect everyone in the house, absolutely everyone.
Okay.
So we cannot guarantee that that person goes to this house and everyone in the house has to be isolated. So the protocol says, yeah, we will take the one person, send that person home, but it doesn't guarantee that everyone in the house does not leave for 10 days. So that is the challenge that we're having. Keep in mind that Australia had one of the strictest quarantines, and the Delta variant sneaked through that 14-day mandatory hotel quarantine. So when we're talking about the Delta threat, the threat is so great. Another lockdown, running out of oxygen in the Philippines, that kind of threat is so expensive, so devastating, that we're asking our Filipinos, as I understand, to sacrifice.
So you believe, I mean, fully vaccinated people, I think the quarantine's now 7 days, correct?
From a green zone.
Yes. So you agree with this?
Oh, yes. I mean, it's not that I agree with it.
But
the science supports that a 10-day quarantine is 99.7% effective. So
okay.
In fact, the Delta variant, the people will say, is still 14 days. But we have shortened it to 10 days. We have added a 0.3% risk. And the government has decided that that risk is great enough to allow our kababayans to enter and to shorten it by 4 days. But there are many countries now that are maintaining the 14 days. Hong Kong is 21 days in the hotel.
Okay. All right. Now, Sinovac is applying for an EUA to vaccinate children 3 years old and above. What do you make of that? I know that in the Western world, it's only Pfizer that's been cleared to be used for teenagers. But Sinovac clearly is the one vaccine that has a big inventory, frankly, right? So it would be very difficult to get more Pfizer, more Moderna, but Sinovac is there. How do you, what do you make of Sinovac for kids?
Well, I trust that the FDA that has firsthand knowledge of the data. I don't, I've never seen the data. So if the FDA approves, then it will be a boon for the Philippines because we can begin to inoculate our children if it, if the FDA determines it is safe and efficacious. And remember, the Sinovac technology has been around for 100 years. So we have been vaccinating children with a killed virus for a long time. So we have experience with that. And so when I talk to parents who have a choice between Sinovac and Pfizer, I say, look, Sinovac is has been around for 100 years.
Yeah.
And I think I would like to conclude by saying this. The Delta variant, it appears to infect children at higher numbers,
okay,
which is why there is a concern now to protect our children as well.
Mm-mm. All right. On that note, Father Nick Austriaco, appreciate. Before we go, I just want to ask this. I know that this has been a while already, but the Bloomberg Resiliency Ranking that ranked Philippines 52 out of 53. You have Secretary Duque saying it's unfair. He was pissed. And but no less than the WHO yesterday saying the barometers were unfair because what would be right is to compare the Philippines to middle income countries as well, with those also challenged in acquiring vaccines. What do you make of that?
You know, I am a Filipino American and I have been struck by the tremendous gap between the US and the Philippines, my two home countries, with regards to access to vaccines. Mm-mm. So I am not going to fault the government at this time for the delayed rollout. I mean, we just simply could not get vaccines. Mm-hmm. So in terms of the vaccines, and I've been privileged to attend some of the daily briefings for the National Vaccine Operations Center, and I've been impressed. I've been impressed that given the severe global shortage, the Philippine government is doing as best as it can, given that limitation, to roll out to protect the Filipino people. Now, there are economic considerations, there are educational considerations. It is distressing that our young people, our children, have not been able to do face-to-face in a year. That is a concern for me as well. But I have discovered that there are unique challenges in the Philippines for our children. We can protect them at school, but I found out that they take the public transportation. So you can try to protect them at school, but if they get on the jeepney, then they're exposed. So there are these are not challenges in the States. So yeah. I'm still learning about the unique opportunities and sufferings that we have here.
Mm-mm. So is it right to say, Father Nick, you also feel that the Bloomberg survey, that ranking was unfair?
Well, again, I am saying that if there's apples and oranges, and
yes,
who are you comparing it to? People will say, let's say compare Australia to the US. Now, there you see there's a huge problem. If you compare the US, Australia to us, we are doing better with vaccinations than Australia. That's amazing, given that Australia is a first world country with significant economic resources that we do not have.
On that note, Father Nick Austriaco, thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Karen,
I hope to see you again, sir.
God bless you.
God bless you too.